welcome to We're on the Pier. Guess who's here? I'm going to meet people and I'm going to talk to people who are visiting the pier, who work on the pier, who are based in Brighton, a real selection of exciting people. Join me, Yael Breuer. You don't have to be a West Ham supporter to enjoy this. You don't have to be a football fan to enjoy this. But this is an incredible story that touches upon football, but is a podcast in a historical context. And I have Simon and Ashley with me to talk about that. Producer Simon, let's start with you. What is this podcast that's just been awarded a prestigious award?
The podcast is called The Boleyn Brothers. It's the story of the West Ham Palace Battalion during World War I. It's based upon true fact, but the core of the story is fictional. And it's just won Best Drama Podcast 2019 at the International Programme Radio Awards in New York.
You need an award just to be able to remember
yes,
that.
Yes, absolutely.
So give me the gist of the story. What happened then?
In 1914, the mayor of West Ham put out a call for recruits to join up to go into the battlefield. He did it in at the club, and a lot of the supporters basically joined up and were recruited.
So he just announced at the football club, we need people to come and fight. Mm. And all these football fans did.
They did, they joined up. The whole story was recorded in the war diary of the battalion. The second adjutant, Frank Jens, wrote the very first entry in the war diary and wrote the very last entry in the war diary. The battalion was disbanded in February 1918. So they went through all the major campaigns during World War I.
So for the duration of the war, football fans got together, fought, many of whom died.
Yes. Most of them died.
Most of them died.
And were replaced.
And replaced by more West Ham supporters.
Yeah, absolutely.
This is incredible. Yeah. Ashley, you produced the music, you designed the music for this. And you have an amazing, you had an amazing experience trying to recreate the original.
Yeah, Simon's researchers managed to find a snippet of the original regimental march. And I was in the army for quite a long time, in the British Army, so I know a lot about marches. I was in a band. So he found the march, and we kind of extrapolated the rest of it. And so kind of rewrote it. It was probably written. I mean, a lot of those marches come from Italian operettas and things like that. So it was probably written by Donizetti or somebody. But it's not hard to figure out how a march works, especially if you've played thousands of them for years on end. And then we went up to London and recorded the stuff on original instruments, so instruments that you would have found at that period.
Like what?
Like an ophicleide, which is a...
Ophicleide?
Kind of like ophicleide, yeah. It's like a weird... It looks like a baritone saxophone, but you play it with a brass mouthpiece, basically. It's kind of a giant keyed bugle would be the best way to describe it.
So you had real people playing real
things, ophicleides. Yeah. And then you mix it all together. And I mean, it's one person playing all the trumpet parts and another person playing all the ophicleide and tuba. And I did all the trombones and then you get some woodwinds in.
Right.
So we used bits of the theme of the march as well as musical stings and beds throughout the...
Okay, and obviously the result has been very successful, and you won this prestigious award, which is going to be given in New York soon, yes?
Yes,
On Monday, we're flying over on Concorde.
Are you surprised?
We've got it out of mothballs, we're flying over Sunday night.
Yes. No, that's a real achievement. I'm just trying to think if anything equivalent could happen today. I mean, in a football club, someone standing up and saying, come on, guys, let's go and... I can't, but, you know.
I think it was a product of its time.
Very much,
yes. Great, so how can we listen to it?
The easiest way is to do a search on Google for the other 1%.
The other 1%, that's your own production
that
company?
That's the podcast brand.
Right.
That's what the Boleyn Brothers have been released under. It's a podcast that goes out every Friday.
Okay.
We produce between 10 minutes and half an hour of original drama that goes out every Friday. Of which Boleyn Brothers was part of it.
Okay, the other 1%.
The other 1%.
Congratulations and thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Join your friends in a West End battalion who've already enlisted.
How about it, lads?
Are you kidding?
Let's get a medic!
Too late for that.
He's a kid. He shouldn't have been here. It stinks, the whole thing stinks.
Wake up!
What?
George, you are dreaming. Bad dreams.
Listen up, lads. New orders. We're on the move again.
Where are we headed, sir?
The Somme.
You were supposed to look after him.
This is it, lads. Grab any of these shell holes and claim it for Blighty.
The Boleyn Brothers. Stories with attitude for mature listeners.
Jason, who is by far the smartest person on the pier today, is here. Jason, will you succeed? Tell me, what do you do? You work here, right?
Yes, I do. I'm the HR director for the group.
For the group who owns the pier?
Yes, so I'm down here for the day, but I've been with on the pier itself for about 15 years.
Right, so. And where are you based normally?
Between here, London, Glasgow. So we covered all the various different divisions that the company own.
And you clearly timed it today.
Yes, I tried. I tried to bring the sun with me. It's not so easy when I have to go up to Glasgow, but I do try and take it wherever I go.
Well, you've succeeded today. Tell me, what do you think about Brighton Pier?
Well, I'm terribly biased, I suppose.
That's
I haven't
okay.
been here so long. It's like my own home. But I think we've seen it from the public's point of view. It's certainly the variety. You know, this is a whole day out, you know, in one place, everything from the restaurants, the rides. It appeals to all ages. There's plenty to do. It's ideally located, which saves me having to advertise it today. You can just look around and see it. And I think that's it. I think it's an adventure for younger kids. You know, it's... there's so much to see and do. There's for families, there are places where you can sit and relax and have a bit of a break. But also for older generations,
yes.
the amount of people that will sit here and we'll sort of sit and have a chat with them, and they've got stories about the old days and what it used to be like. And it's such an iconic part of Brighton. A friend of mine messaged me the other day. He watches sort of old classic TV programs. I think it was The Persuaders or something. He's saying, the pier's on from 1917, it's totally different. So it's always been, you know, it's always been an iconic, not just place for Brighton, but for England as well.
Absolutely. It is one of the most visited attractions in the country.
It is, yes. We're very proud of that fact, yes. It feels like they've all come at once in the middle of summer, it has to be said. But
yes,
you can get a bit hectic. But it is like your own home. You do care about what people think when they get here. You know, I see it from the team's point of view. We've got such a high retention rate for employees because it is like a community.
Right.
You know.
Right.
And it's nice to bring new people in each year to become a part of that.
Yeah. Oh, that's really lovely to hear, because we have been interviewing people. The variety that you're talking about is the essence of it. But it's really nice to know that from your perspective, you know, from an employer's perspective, you feel the same about the staff as well as the
visitors. Oh, yeah, yes. It's important. We treat everybody as individuals. Everybody has a story, is what
yes,
I always say.
Absolutely.
You know. But I don't like that people feel they're caught up a machine. Everyone's got something to offer, and I think that is reflected in low turnover rates. We get repeat staff coming back every year for being a part of this. So yes, it's
a happy place.
It is a very happy place.
Thank you so much.
No problem at all.
Thank
no
you.
Problem.
You're from Johannesburg, right?
Yes.
Is there anything like this in South Africa? A pier like this anywhere?
Not in Joburg. There is a similar pier in Durban, but there's not as much activity on. It's more just a pier that you walk out and view. So this is a lot of activity. We were amazed at the rides and everything.
Right. And you said that Cape Town is a little bit like Brighton, has a similar vibe, is that right?
A little bit, yes. It's a very friendly city. And when I look at this, the high-rise buildings, it looks like Cape Town.
A little bit.
And Cape Town is beautiful. Come visit.
Oh, I'd love to. All right. Thank you so much.
Okay,
enjoy the rest of your stay. Bye.
Bye.
That's it for part one. Join me in part two for some more interesting guests. Welcome back to part two of We're on the Pier. Guess who's here with me? Yael Breuer. I'm going to meet some more interesting people, some writers, some artists, some musicians, some visitors, some members of staff from the pier. We're going to talk about wrestling, but wrestling with a difference or even with a positive message. And I'm joined here by Dann, Emily and Rebel to explain the whole concept to me. So Emily, if we can start with you. You're coming to Brighton with a show on behalf of Eve. What is Eve?
So Eve is a wrestling company and we're an all-women's company. And what we're about is showing loud women who are just unapologetic, take up space. They're superheroes come to life.
Right, okay. So this is coming to Brighton, but it's more than just a show, right? It's a kind of movement. It has an ethos. It has some, a message that you want to convey. Do you want to expand a bit about that?
Absolutely. What we're about, as I said with the strong women, what we're about is really showing something that's special, something that you can watch and really feel connected to, something that can make you feel stronger. You can scream and shout when you're at the show, which gives you that really big release.
So it's empowering for the people who
empowering,
are watching.
Exactly.
The people who are performing, presumably, as well, to an
yep.
extent.
And a really important thing to us as a company is that when people come and watch one of our events, it is a safe space.
Right.
If anyone uses any form of hate speech at all, they're immediately removed from the building. We don't allow them to come back to any of our events either.
Okay.
So it is just really knowing that people enjoy themselves when they're relaxed, and that is what we're about.
Interesting. Dann, tell me a little bit about the practicalities. What's happening with this pro wrestling with a difference, I suppose?
Well, Eve itself, as Emily was just saying, isn't your standard wrestling show. As much as it's a pro wrestling show, like, you're going to have a number of people who are seeing this that are aware of WWE, which is the big American company. And a number of the people that have wrestled for Eve also have then gone on to become champions of WWE. And indeed, sometimes we even feature some of those people. But Eve has really captivated an audience unlike any other wrestling promotion in the UK, and I think that's what's led to the success and the reason why we've, been 2 years of consecutive sellout shows in London, and the reason why we're able to come down to Brighton. As Emily said, it has a message. It's not just a wrestling show, it's a movement. It is about empowerment, and it really isn't my place to speak about it, but it's Emily, as I'm the guy here that's that's just the wrestling guy. But what we show with the actual Eve shows themselves is that this idea that, women can't wrestle is completely false. I've worked in the wrestling business for 20 years. I've worked with the biggest names for everyone from, even in Hulk Hogan, and everyone knows who Hulk Hogan is. I will hand on heart put my money down in saying that the Eve shows themselves are the best live event wrestling experience that anyone can actually have. And it's, you were just saying, it's like, again, more than wrestling, there's also the Eve Academy.
Right.
The Eve Academy is the London School of Women's Wrestling. It's the only women's wrestling school. It is actually something that Rebel Kinney here is a graduate of. And what we find with Eve is that there'll be a number of people who really, understand and, what Eve's ethos is about. And they will come to an Eve event, they'll love it, they'll love the punk rock attitude, they'll love the feminist attitude, they love the pile driver fascist attitude, they love what Eve is about, and then they'll come down to Eve Academy the next day when we run it, And they'll even though they've never seen any other wrestling, they'll be like, I've got to be a part of this. Right. This is so cool.
We do have women where in everyday life I've felt strongly and I've loved seeing other women who feel this too. We have that person trapped in our heads, that absolute, the boss, the woman who takes no prisoners, the woman who can walk in and take charge, who will be listened to in a meeting, who doesn't have to sit meekly.
Right.
And along with teaching wrestling at Eve Academy, a really big thing is to help women release the person they are in their head.
Wonderful.
Release that confidence. And that's, we see women arrive and then even after the first session, there's
they
a difference.
Transform.
And they'll say like, I stood up to my boss. Right. It was amazing. And right. It's so, so beautiful
that
to
is
see.
Really cool when you get people who like start at Eve Academy and they're like so shy and you know they don't even stand in the front, you know, they'll be like hiding as, you know, far in the back, you know, and you have to really kind of like draw it out of them, but they're there because they want that, you know, they
sure.
want to become natural.
Sure.
You know, wrestling is the place where the person at the back of the classroom can transform themselves into a character that stands at the front and delivers that great monologue,
right,
you
okay.
know, or dives off a 20-foot high balcony. It can be all sorts
it could
of
be
things.
Anything. Yeah. All right. So I'm going to ask you in a minute about having been to the academy, and maybe you're going to show us a little bit about what you've studied there. But let's just go into the practicalities of the show. What is it called? Where and when?
So the show is called She Brawls in Brighton.
Right.
It's at the Brighton Centre, and it is on Friday, the 28th of June.
And you're going to bring all the. The ring and
oh gosh,
oh,
everything.
Yeah,
we're gonna have a, you know, a 16-foot ring there that stands at 8 feet high. You're gonna have wrestlers from all over Japan. You're gonna have wrestlers from America, and you're gonna have Rebel Kinney taking on the best in the world as well.
You will be right in the action, standing directly up against the ring,
wow.
just like you would in a music gig, going to watch a band.
Yeah, that's what it is. It's there's nothing else like the live theatrical. Action wrestling stunt show that is an Eve event.
I'm excited, and I'm
Good.
Even more excited to be a bit of a star of wrestling myself now.
Are you going to be performing on the show?
Well,
are we going to see something here? We're going to get something.
You're going to see something now.
Oh wow! I'm going to get out of the way then. It's
right.
like I'm
oh,
fearing for my
too.
Life if you two are going to start wrestling now.
Okay, I'm up for it. Okay, Rebel, I'm all yours. Tell me, well, let's start with something basic that the academy teaches.
Something basic. So the first thing you want to learn when you're wrestling is the lockup. That's where the match starts, and that's where every move thereafter comes from.
So the lockup means that I'll be locked. I won't be able to.
Well, we'll both be locked in together.
In together.
Yes.
Okay.
It's called the collar and elbow tie-up.
Right.
And much like the name, you want to have one hand on the collar and the other right on the elbow.
All right.
So first off, we want to have left leg forward, right leg back. That's it. So we just interlock nicely.
Mm-hmm.
And you want to bring left arm and hand right on the back of the neck. And this one's right on there. That's it. That's a nice lock up there. So then if we break that and then we come in straight from there. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So leading with the left.
Okay.
Right. And go. So.
Oh no.
Close enough. And then from here, I'm going to put you in a headlock.
Right.
And literally, I will have a lock on your head and you will feel it. So I'm going to throw that away and bring that
oh
in right
God, that
there.
Was quick.
And then we can still have you looking right there at all the people.
Yes, I'm sure it's a pretty sight. Can I try and get out of this?
I mean, you can certainly try.
Maybe not. All right. Where's Dann now? Great. Okay. Thanks for the demonstration.
No problem.
And have fun at the show. I'm looking forward to it.
I definitely will.
Thank you.
Remy is the owner of the new cocktail bar on the pier. Hello, Remy.
Hiya.
Tell me a little bit about this place. It's fantastic.
Well, we just opened it like a month ago now. It used to be just a normal random terrace open court, and we just built that cocktail bar there.
Right.
We make about like 700 cocktails every day during
the
weekends. So it's quite cool, yeah.
And if the weather continues to be like
this... It might be even better, yeah. That's what we're waiting for.
So it's called the Sunset Garden.
The Sunset Garden, yeah. It's all about DJ, live music and everything during the weekend.
Right.
So it's quite cool.
great. And you came from the south of France?
I'm coming from France. I was in London for 2 years, and I moved in Brighton just for the pier to work there.
Great. Are you hoping to create a little bit of a French atmosphere here?
Just the weather. Sometimes I do miss the weather.
Right.
We can't say we have the best weather here, but it's fine. Right. We deal with it.
And you must meet people from all over the world. Just
we do. We do. We're meeting like so many people. For example, like Easter, we got 250,000 people.
Wow, so it's like
very, very big,
people.
Yeah. Just in 3 days, yeah.
Great. So when people come here, what do they expect? To sit down, be served?
They're just sitting down, they're ordering cocktail, they're listening to the music, they're looking at the view. They almost all have a second one because they're really good. It's all homemade, like you can see she's doing it everything.
Yes.
So yeah, it's quite cool.
Fantastic. Great. After filming, we might even sample
you want to try
ourselves.
One?
We'd love to. Thank you so much.
You're very welcome. Okay. Thank you.
Right, Sarah and Laura, let's hear from you. Why are we on the pier today, Sarah?
So we've come to Brighton for a couple of days because I used to live here, so we're just visiting for a few days altogether.
Yeah. Right, and you have a guest with you from New Zealand, is that right? Who's just hiding?
Yeah, yes. Yes, I've just spent the last 2 years in New Zealand, so he's my partner and I've brought him to show him my side of the world, basically.
Right, and you live in Essex.
Near South End, yes.
And is Brighton Pier a place that you've been coming to anyway?
We love it. We love it here. When we came to visit her when she lived here, we always came here. But my husband, who's also hiding, had never been on the pier. So we thought we'd come and have a look and have a coffee and enjoy the sunshine.
Great. And that's it from the pier today. Join me every night on Latest TV at 8:30. Good night. I'm going to go to the side of the camera.